Father, right now we come before your presence. Father, we come before you in the spirit and humble us, Father. Father, while you have allowed us to assemble together one more time, we ask the Holy Spirit right now to fill this place. We welcome you now, Holy Spirit. Fill this place. Fill this house. And we will reverence your presence even now. In the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. I don't know about you, but I will rejoice and be glad in it. I don't know about you. I've been waiting the whole week for this moment. I don't know about you. I've been waiting to tell somebody about the goodness of Jesus. I don't know about you, but some of y'all I haven't seen in a while. So while you are up in here today, let me tell you about Jesus. I don't know about you, but I came to do only one thing. I came to lift up the name of Jesus. I came to give him glory. I came to magnify the Lord. So if that's who you are today, I wish somebody would stand on your feet and give the Lord some praise. I wish somebody would stand on their feet and let the Lord know how much you love him. I wish somebody would stand on their feet and just say, Jesus, I thank you this morning. The Bible says that the Lord is great and he's greatly to be praised. How many have a praise in your spirit? How many know that the Lord is great? How many know that the Lord is good? I don't know about you. Let me hear you make some noise. Make some noise. Make some noise. Because God is good. God is great. God is an awesome God. Yes, no. I'm glad this morning. I'm glad this morning. I'm excited this morning because God is great. Are we ready to go higher? Are we ready to go higher? Let's go a little higher, amen. Let's go a little higher. We'll be right back.
Good morning, Saint Steve.
Good morning.
Your scripture reading this morning will be coming from the 117th number of Psalms. Psalm 117. And it reads, "Oh, praise the Lord, all ye nations. Praise him, all ye people. For his merciful kindness is great towards us. And the truth of the Lord endureth forever. Praise ye the Lord."
Amen.
Courage,
standing for your name's sake.
not about us, it's about you. It's about elevating your name before this world, because the world is crept into the church. We need to drive them out of the church. Drive the world out of the church. And the only way we can do that is by standing for Jesus Christ. Oh, thank you, Father. We pray for this congregation as a whole to seek the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all the things that we stand in need of, we already know. So we just want to be humble enough and meek enough to get out of our way. Let the Spirit rule and abide in us.
Yes, sir.
Give over to the Spirit of God. Surrender. That His will may be done, not ours. So we preach for, we thank you for the ones that are going to stand in John's shoes today. And declare the word of righteousness.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
The one that we should worship and give honor to, because he's done so For your mercy never Stephen's amen. Amen, amen, amen. Well, the way that we give here, amen, some have already given through the church app and or even through their mailing in, their offering, or what have you, amen. But if you have not given and you would like to give, amen, the Bible says love the cheerful giver.
Amen.
Amen. So as he has purpose in your heart to give, amen, you may give on your way out. We have tithes and offering boxes outside of the sanctuary, so don't go home with that money in your pocket. Amen. Amen. You won't feel well. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 You know what God does, amen? Because of your giving, look at what God is able to do with the church. Amen. 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 So we're just going to thank the Lord right now. Amen. Amen. Look up, amen. You may give through Giblify or Tithely if you want to give through the church app, St. Stephen's Cash App, amen. Now, if you want to drop in cash, you may drop in your cash in the boxes outside the door. Amen, amen, amen. Because what does God do? He allows the church to be here in the neighborhood.
Yes, right.
Amen. Even for somebody like me when I was lost. Amen. That somebody might drop into the house of the Lord. Amen. And say, and just to get a word from him. Amen. I was asked the question, why do I go to church? One of my cousins. Because it's life unto me. Amen. 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 And the Bible says, man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Amen. Amen. So that we might drop in one day, and somebody might come through that church door one day and say, I just need to sit here and get my mind right. Amen. Amen. So that's why we give. That's why we come. Amen. So let's pray. Father God, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Give you all praise, honor, and glory. Lord, we thank you for the ability to give, Lord. Lord, because you made it all possible, Lord. Everything belonged to you. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that some of us didn't even have to go to work to get what you gave us, Lord. The Lord, all we have to do is wait on a certain time of the month, amen. Amen. And check our bank accounts, Lord, to see what you have done for us, Lord. So, Lord, we thank you, Lord. Lord, we pray for those that have a desire to give, Lord, and that will give. Lord, we thank you, Lord. For you say it's better to give than receive. For giving is of you, Lord. For the Bible says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him shall not perish but have eternal life. And Jesus, you said that I came that they may have life and have it more abundantly. So we thank you right now. Lord, bless in Jesus' name. Amen.
Much more I can take.
Come on,
see, I decided.
too hard. Everything I've been through, it ain't been too hard.
I said, what a mighty God we serve. Oh, have God not been good to you? Have God not brought you through something? When you were down and out, what a mighty God you called upon. Oh, it's prayer time in the house of the Lord. Those that are willing to come to the altar, you're welcome to come at this time. Those who just want to sit at your seat, that's fine too. But hold somebody's hand, because you don't know what that person next to you might be going through. But I know we serve a mighty God, a true God, a healer, a way maker. Oh, what a friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. All of our sins and griefs to bear. My God said, bring your burdens. Oh, bring them to my God and leave them there. He's a mighty good God. He hears and he answers your prayer. Bread of heaven, the whole bread of heaven, bread of heaven, bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Feed me till I want no more. God, we come to you this morning. Lord, with our heads bowed, our hearts in prayer. Father God, coming just to say thank you. Thank you for another moment just to be able to be in your house. Just to be able to lift up the name of Jesus. But Father God, you're worthy. You're worthy. You're worthy. And Father God, we just want to praise you. We just want to praise you. We just want to lift you up. For Father God, last night as we slept and slumbered, Lord, you watched over us all night long. Father God, we woke this morning falling out of bed, so I was not our cooling board. Our cover was not a whining sheet. And Father God, we just say thank you for allowing our moments just to roll on just a little while longer. Oh Lord, you've been good. So good. You've been so good. So good. And Father God, we just ask that as we come in your house this morning, Father God, whatever may be troubling us, whatever may be in the way that hinder us from calling upon you, Lord, we just beg and ask right now in the name of Jesus, Father God, that it be removed right now, Lord Jesus. Remove it right now in the name of Jesus. Father God, open up our hearts and open up our minds. Father God, that we'll be clear as to who you are and what you have done. Father God, we thank you. We thank you right now for all your many, many blessings. Father God, we just ask that you forgive us, Father God. Forgive us all of our sins. Whether it's sins of omission or sins of commission. For you have said in your word that we all have sinned and come short of your glory. And Father God, we just say thank you right now. Father God, we just ask that you look down upon us and take us, mold us, change our life, Father God, so that we can walk in the path that you have laid for us to walk. Father God, that you can guide us in the way that you have us to go. Father God, that we may study your undefined word. Father God, that we can be bold enough to tell the dying world that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And we thank you, Father God. Father God, we thank you right now for our children. Father God, as they prepare themselves to return to school, Lord Jesus, we just ask that you just build a fence around them. Father God, guide them and protect them. Father God, not only the children, but the administrators, all those that deals with the school system every day. Father God, we just ask that you build a fence around them. Father God, protect them as only you can. And Father God, we just ask now that you look down upon the sick and the shut in. Oh, Father God, we know one touch, or just a touch from the Master's hand, will make everything all right. And Father God, we ask that you look down upon the bereaved this morning. Oh, Father God, we ask for strength. Father God, for we know that you're able to do all things but make a mistake. And Father God, we give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. And Father God, we just ask that you look down upon the man that's going to write the word this morning. Lord, Father God, we just ask for that you strengthen him. Give him a word from heaven that may pierce our heart. Father God, that some man, some woman, some boy or girl may come running and say, what is it I must do to be saved? Father God, for we're living in rough times. We're living in hard times. But Father God, we know that you are able to take away all of our hard times. And we thank you for it. Father God, we just ask for your grace and we ask for your mercy. Father God, for we know that your grace is sufficient for all things. And Father God, we just give you glory. We give you honor. Father God, for you paid a price that no one could have paid. For you died out on Golgotha here. Died that we too might have a right to the tree of life. And we just stop by and say thank you. We just stop by and say thank you. We just stop by and say thank you. We just stop by and give you praise. We just stop by to lift up the name of Jesus. But Father God, you're worthy. You're worthy. You're worthy. You're worthy of all of our praise. We thank you now in the mighty and powerful name of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. These and all blessings we ask in your name. Amen. Amen. And amen. Thank you.
Ephesians chapter 2, beginning at verse 13. Church have it, let them say amen.
Amen.
But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were afar off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make of himself of twain one, new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them that were not. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now, therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are built together for a habitation of God through the Spirit.
Amen.
As the motto of what today is, the anniversary of our church reunion, the family that prayed. Yes, it's together.
Yes, sir.
But the family that prayed, you may be seated in the name of the Lord.
That's all right.
Prayer is the key to the kingdom. Now, what unlocks the door? Now, what is faith? It's the substance of things that are hoped for in your mind that are not really manifested out into this, but it's substance of what you hope for. But it's also the evidence, because it's not seen yet.
That's all right.
Now, what brings it to being seen is what God just gave to us through his word. Jesus the Christ came here as an answer to the question of why in the world did Adam and Eve disobey God? It's the truth. Because if Adam and Eve had not, that garden would spread all over. Because see, within him, who? God, we live and move and we have our very being. God is everything. And everywhere.
Come on.
That's how come when he finally came back to Moses on that mountain, when that bush was burning. Now let's think about what happened before that bush started burning. God called Abram. Now if you want to know all this, this right here that we use to look good on the coffee table. And we open up into them books that we pay $40, $50 for, to have right in the middle of it, the 23rd Psalms and all our favorite scriptures. There's something that go with your favorite scriptures. The rest of the God's word. That's why when Paul was teaching Timothy, and he wrote that book of Timothy, that we all can put, say, 2 Timothy 2:15, it says, study to make yourselves approved. Stop dropping that word in God. Approved to God. We got to be approved unto God. Not just to our approval. The reason why the Lord God had me write down and go through all these notes and trouble my wife for a week and a half after the Lord laid on Pastor's heart to give me this assignment, God will work with your heart and your spirit if you let him do it. Now, why am I going around like that? Because you see, God does not really throw nobody into the yoke.
No.
Each one of us is a representative. How much of a representative depends on how much we listen to God and how much we do for God. Getting back to the word about prayer. Prayer is when we open ourselves up to. When we have that little thing, we talk about something talking to me. That something is not something. That something is someone. That's the Holy Spirit of God tugging on your heart through the Holy Spirit, because Jesus wants us all saved. Because what that scripture we just read says that all these other things and ordinances were broken down, because the reason why God came through to Abram, because God had tried with Adam, Eve, and all of those beforehand, Noah, all of them, to talk to us the way he wanted to talk with Eve and Adam in the garden. But there was an interlude that got into the serpent and told one lie. God told Adam what? All the fruit in this garden, you can freely eat of. But there's two trees.
That's right.
Yeah, it's going to get down to one, Deacon Island. But there's two trees.
That's right.
In the midst of the garden.
Come on now.
One, you even know, talk about the tree of life. You can freely eat of it right now. But the one that's next to it,
come on now,
is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. In the day that you eat of it,
yes,
you shall surely die.
Yes.
Okay. God created the helpmeet Eve. The serpent was up into the tree where he wasn't supposed to be. And Adam, he walked up there and he said, to eat. Did not God truly say you can eat of everything? And she said, yes, we can, of everyone but of the tree of the life. Tree of, no, not life. A lot of folks want to say that, but it's not the tree of life. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil that we cannot eat, can't even touch. When she said touch, God said, don't add to or take away anything of my word. God did not tell her that she couldn't touch. And the reason that the Lord is giving y'all this through me, because God called me to mostly teach his word. I'm a teacher. I know that he also called me to preach. And every preacher has to be asked to teach. There's a pilgrim sitting up there. But what we got to understand is this. You can be a teacher. But the first thing a teacher has to be is what? Has to be a student. If you're not willing to be a good student, you won't be yoked by God to be a teacher.
Amen.
And I'm going to leave that alone and let y'all talk to God about it.
Amen.
So when Serpent looked at her and said, you won't surely die. Now, brothers, don't sit up here and think y'all finna get off. Because Adam was standing right next to him. He could have said, put that down.
That's what he could say.
Let's go talk to God to get this right. But you know how sometimes we say, well, I'm going to see what happens to her first. Because I've been looking at that. I guess I can let her test it. She did.
Not that.
She turned. Wow, she didn't know that. Let me see what happened. And then suddenly, immediately, their eyes came open. But that wasn't the thing. What started rushing through their mind was stuff they couldn't handle. Now, I'm going to bring it on down. First high.
Okay.
I don't care what's on, but that first high blow your mind. And you start chasing the rock.
Come on.
Yeah, I've been out there. I'm in the house of God. I'm going to tell the truth. But they knew that something had to be done. So Adam took some fig leaves and tried, and they went and hid. And when God came through the garden at the regular time, who did he call? Bible readers. He called Adam. He didn't say nothing about Eve. Why? God left Adam in charge. Okay, we know the rest of the story down on through there. So let's get to when God called Abram. Abram, I want you to leave your father's house and to go to a place. I'll let you know when you get there. He did it. But God told Abram, take just you and your family. But Abram knew that his nephew Lot was going to be missing his daddy and family. He didn't want to leave him by himself. Well, you know what happens when we try and add to what God tells us? I ain't going to be long. He took Lot. And I think that's how come God had him named Lot in the Bible, because Lot was a lot of headache. They went out, and we know we're going to bring it on down. God told Israel when he set them up, I'm giving you God's word when he delivered them through Moses. Because when he called Moses up on that hill, because Moses had been saying, when are we going to get out of here? Because you know what happened to Moses. We seen the Ten Commandments, even though they made the skin of you wrong. We saw the Ten Commandments. And Moses was delivered by his mother by putting him in a basket. And where did he end up? He ended up in the enemy king's household. In the enemy's house. And the enemy brought him up, taught him everything he knew. Except for one thing. Moses kept hearing and hearing and hearing and seeing and found out that he was of the Hebrew heritage. And he chose to go back there. We know what happened. He and his big brother fell out. Moses was out there. He ended up running to the hills. Got up there and he was sheep herding because he fell in love with a pretty woman like I did and became a part of the house. While he was out there tending them sheep, something miraculous happened. He kept seeing this bush on this hill that was burning, but it wouldn't burn up. So he said, let me go check out what's going on. And when he got close, all of a sudden he heard the voice of somebody he had been praying to. God. And he said, hold it, before you go any further, take those shoes off because you're on holy ground.
All right.
And God said, I've heard the cries of your people because Moses got straight to it. If you are the God, you're the God of Abraham, Isaac, then why you let us be living like this? We know why. Because we wouldn't behave. Sometimes we wonder how can we end up in the jams that we're in? Because we want to do what we want to do.
Come on.
Not just the children. Because when God bless a house with children, I don't care if they come together and the child is conceived and they haven't been this piece of paper put on it, but you know what's in your heart. And God acts on that. So what happens? You get mixed up because you get hearing different stories and different this and people worship different that and all these other things. God gave Israel to be a nation that would live exactly by his word and intent to show the rest of the world how you can be blessed. Because God, when he called Israel out of Egypt and took them through that desert, did they ever lose a battle?
No.
Not until they came up along this little group called Ai. Back in that house, he had been seeing how Israel was, I'm just going to use the terminology, kicking everybody behind and thinking that they were so good that hey, I love those small group, and they always had always remembered to take the ark of God with them and pray to God and ask God. This time they didn't do it. Sent a little band down to Ai, and Ai sent them back home running. And Joshua got on his knees and prayed and said, Lord, and God said, get up off your knees. You know what's wrong. You go into that camp, and you know who did it, and you come and you let them know. We don't do nothing in life without God.
That's right.
But getting right back to that text, I want you to look at chapter 18 of the book of Matthew, around the 20th and the 21st verse, because we always quote it, but let's see if we really know what it's talking about. It says that wherever two or three are gathered in my name, but there's things that we sometimes need out, touching and agreeing. Touching and agreeing. That's what I love about this weekend, this day. We've come together. Because you know what? We touch one another. I think it's 95% of everybody in here knows each other or knows one to another. We're tightly knit, formed together. But what brought us together? The love on this hill that comes out of God's church. Yes. Are we willing to say amen and agree on that?
Yes.
So we've touched and we've agreed, have we not? That's how come there's power in this house today. There's been so much love on this hill this weekend because we touched and we've agreed. Not only have we touched and agreed with one another, we're touching and agreeing with God. Because God says what? Lift up my name. Proclaim my name. He said, how will the people of the world know that you are my children? Because of the love you have for who? Not just for them. Love one another. When we come together, touching and agreeing, and the mission that God has given to St. Stephen's on this hill, I know, because like I said, you count 74 to 2023. I've been a part of this church almost 50 years of a 63-year-old life. My life is in this church. My history is in this church. I know what God can do. Some of you remember crazy Reverend Johnson down there in the postal uniform, get off work, come play with the kids. I baptized a few of you in that other pool and in this. Yes, sister girl, thank you. Yes, sister girl, thank you. You know what, when I walk in here, my eyes get full of tears. And they're not tears of sorrow. They're tears of joy. Joy for what he did. Joy for what he's doing. Joy for what he's brought in his head. But also joy knowing what the potential is that can be done on the same hill. How many of you in here are willing to admit that you knew that when Reverend Griffin first got the vision for God to build this building, that everybody and all the others were saying, man, you need to get up out of there. You need to get off that hill. No, he did not get off this hill because he knew the assignment was to whoever come up on this hill to stay here with the love that God has planted on this hill. Now the thing of it is, will you follow God's vision and keep on doing it? What did that scripture say? You now, right now, where God is, where he's building, what he's doing. Because you know what? How many of us are willing to admit that we've heard somewhere down through our lives and years from other churches, other regions, and everything else say, how does St. Stephen's do that in that area that they're in? We know there ain't no people with no money over there. All they got is that Fort Sam Houston. No, we got more than Fort Sam Houston. We got Jesus. And in this Bible, I believe in the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians says, in around the second chapter, it says, God takes the foolishness of those who are not as so well educated and confound those who think they wise and know something. How many have tried and failed in all other places? Well, guess what St. Stephen's keeps on doing? She just keeps on growing and growing and growing. You know why? Because God has given his blessing here.
Amen.
And he gives us mighty leaders.
Amen.
But you know what it falls on? Do we believe it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, it may not look like what people think as much, but if you look with a what? Spiritual eye,
yes,
you see a mountain of blessing. How many of us are willing to admit what God has brought into and done in our lives because we've passed through the St. Stephen's? Yeah, I raise my hands. Matter of fact, I raise both of them. I raise my pick up both my heels. But like I said, when I came here, I found what I had left. I said, I really don't want to do it, but I can't help it. Laced through the history of this church is my family on both sides. The founding minister, Obi, who was in fellowship with Greater Corinth, there was a pastor at Greater Corinth. His name was John Henry Hardiman Sr. He had a little sister. We know her as Sister Lula Mae Hardiman.
Amen.
I call her Aunt Lula out of respect. But she's really my cousin. John Henry Hardiman Sr. is my mother's uncle. He sent to Pittsburgh, Texas for my mother and her sisters because they were being mistreated where they were born in Pittsburgh, Texas by my grandfather.
Have mercy then.
He brought them here and he got them working in the Terrell Hills area.
All right.
They were domestic.
Yes,
sir.
Mama was too.
Whoa. My daddy met my mother. And on his side of the family, there was a church built across the street from his house on Barber Street. I think his name is Philadelphia Baptist Church on 300 block of Barber Street. My grandfather and his wife helped build that church.
Amen.
And his firstborn son, called him George Bear Johnson, was one of the founding ministers over at Tridestone.
Amen.
Ministry runs through my family.
God bless you.
Both sides. And God brought me here. He took me into the military. He brought me here to prepare me to go into the military, because if I had went into the military with the attitude that I have, two brothers here can say amen, I wouldn't have made it here. But God brought me here. He brought me home. And he wouldn't let me run anymore from the yoke. And I joined the yoke, like I said, a Sunday after Resurrection Day in 1984. Gave my hand and my heart to God, who already had my mind. And what y'all see sitting before you is a product of what God can do.
Praise God.
When he said, like with Jeremiah, he said, before you was made in the womb of your mother, I knew you, and I have sanctified you for a work to do. And guess what? I love the work. And all I'm saying to you is, what the Lord laid on Pastor Ben's heart with that scripture and all what was about it, is the truth. It says, what did it say? The family that prays. Because you know what praying is? Staying in communication with God, agreeing with God, and doing what God tells you to do through the power that God will give you. Yeah, a lot of people are going to tell you, no, you can't. St. Stephen's can tell you, yes, you can.
Yeah. Amen.
But there's one thing you got to do.
All right.
You got to agree with God.
Yes, sir.
Even if you don't like it. Moses says, I can't lead them people. I can't hardly talk. He said, you got your brother Aaron. God will give you.
Yes, sir.
What you got to do is you got to, first of all, give your heart to God.
Yes,
because whether you like it or not, whether you want to admit it or not, he already got your mind.
Yes.
That's how come sometimes you can't sleep, wondering how come, I don't want to do that. God, I don't get what you don't want to do. I'm telling you what you got to do.
Yes, sir.
And this scripture in this word in the back here, when that rich young ruler, when you hear about him, it's written in Mark 10. It's also written in Matthew, 16th chapter, 19th verse 3, talking about that rich young man that came to Jesus.
Uh-huh.
Let's take a look at that. You can't in your Bible, but I'm going to give you a brief synopsis. That was a rich kid.
Yeah.
He had everything he could ever want.
Everything.
He came up to Jesus. He said, good rabbi, master, Jesus said, don't call me good, there's none good but the Father in heaven. What you need? What you talking about? He said, well, I keep the commandments.
That's right.
I keep the law.
Uh-huh.
If I've wronged anybody, I pay them threefold back. I take good care of my workers. Mm-hmm. But I just feel like there's something missing. He said, what must I do? And here's the word, remember about knowing the word? What must I do to inherit eternal life that you're talking about? Does the scripture say we inherit eternal life? Mm-mm. Because you know what it means to inherit something, don't you? just live. You ain't got to behave. You ain't got to do nothing. Just be breathing. When the one whose money belongs to kicks it, it come to you. You don't have to do nothing. But now to get eternal life, you got to do what? First, you got to confess. You got to repent. And you got to yield. I mean, if you want to know, like Sister Chris said, you go up there, you look. Everybody want to talk about Romans 10. You know, start at 18, where it says, you know, the word is nigh thee, even in your mouth. That's the word we preach. That if you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, what? You shall be saved. So guess what? The first part of getting eternal life from the Lord is ours. After. You see, Jesus did his part. He's died on the cross. He lived a sin-free life. God sent him into hell. He took the keys from Lucifer. He brought those that was in the bosom of Abraham. Let them walk and knock upon the doors of the streets of the houses. And now he's waiting to see, will we accept his salvation? But there's others that tell him, you ain't got to go through all that. No, no, you got to. Because it's in the word. That's how come they want to tell you that this word ain't all it's supposed to be. It's everything it needs to be and more. So what do you do, young man? Jesus said, well, if you do all that you're doing, you all right? Well, he said, no, no, I know there's something missing. I feel it inside me. Jesus said, okay, if you will be, Jesus didn't say, he didn't tell him saved, y'all. He said, if you be made whole. Do we know that we're not whole? We're not complete until we have a Holy Spirit of Jesus, of God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit inside of us. Until you have that inside of you, you're not complete. Because God made a complete good man in Adam. And then you read the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. He says, the second Adam.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He made a new one because we messed up the first.
Well.
This is in the Word. I'm not telling you nothing different.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because that's what Jesus was saying in that chapter. When you read from 13 down, he said, he came and he did everything. He's laid it out. He's even teaching it to you. But you have to come to him without any preceived notion. So Jesus told that young man, what you need to be made whole is you got to do this. You got to sell everything you got. That means sell out to the world. Let the world have it. Oh yeah, but you ain't gonna be able to bank the profit. Give it to the poor. Minister to God's people. Then come follow me.
That's right.
That kid did one thing. He looked back at all that he had.
That's right.
I don't care what you got. If you don't have Jesus at the first part of it and using it for Jesus, you got a bunch of worms.
Amen.
You got a bunch of garbage. That's why it's sticking in your nose and you're uncomfortable with it. And then follow me. What did that young man do? If you don't know the context, I'll tell you, you read it when you get there. He turned and he walked away sorrowful. He didn't even open his mouth again. Is that how some of us are right now? We broke off talking to Jesus because he didn't got to that point where he's telling us what we must do that we don't want to do? Oh, I'm a preacher. I'm a preacher. Because I know sometimes when it's preached, it gets quiet. Because what you're doing is you're contemplating. Is this man telling you the truth?
My Lord.
It's in here. Do you believe this? This is the living word. In the beginning was the word was God, the word was with God, and there's nothing that's made that wasn't made by it. That's John, Gospel John, first chapter, first two, three verses. It's the truth.
Yes.
So that rich man walked away, but that wasn't the end of the lesson, brothers and sisters. Family. The family came and asked Jesus and said, what you mean if that guy can't get into heaven, who can? Jesus said, y'all be, what? Y'all don't know? Say, hey. Because Jesus told that rich young man, it's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom. No, God don't want you poor. God didn't want you rich. But he wants you to use the riches for what he wants. Because the earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Because he has created. 24th number of Psalms. God also said, what can you give me? He said, the cattle on a thousand hills is mine. Matter of fact, them hills are mine. Everything is mine. You can't give somebody something that already belongs to them, because what you have, I've given you. But I gave you instructions on how to live with it. I'm not going to go off into that. Read it. You'll find it out. You've already heard it. The thing of it is, we cast it in the back part of our mind, and we don't want to believe what he said about how we're supposed to live with our money. So he told his disciples, he says, if you have given up everything you've got for the kingdom, I'll give you a hundredfold in this life and eternal life.
Yes, sir. Thank
but if you're not using it for what I want you to use it for, I'm going to take it back from you.
My Lord.
That's gospel. And that's what he's saying about touching and agreeing. Yes, he wants his family to pray together. But he also wants his family to follow him together. Because when he does come back, he's going to give assignment to his reapers, the angels, and he's going to take up those that are his. And he's going to know. Because if they find you without Jesus in your heart, God help you. But God ain't going to help you. You got time right now, brothers and sisters. You got time. Use it wisely. Because it says that the moment that the truth come unto you, please harden not your heart. At the moment you truly believe the gospel, harden not your heart. And you know something? The 37th number of Psalms, one of my favorites, says, fret not yourself over evildoers. When you start seeing people that look like they making it, and we know they're dirtier than the dirt on the bottom of our shoes. When we know that, when we see on the news and hear about people doing wrong and all that and everything else, don't be jealous of them, because if you put your hand in God's hand, even in the midst of living among evil people, God will bless you. How do I know? I'm living testimony. I'm a living testimony of what he do. One day when you have time, if you see me, you want to hear it, I'll testify and tell you. Because I love what God did. When he took this wayward child who was going the wrong way and had the mother and father and everybody loving him enough, say, you need to get back in church. We know there's one that you might like. When I pulled up on the campus of the old building and I walked into the church, I felt the same spirit that I felt at home, that I was kicking against, because I said, I am not going to be a preacher. And God said, okay, keep telling that lie. I tried running to California. I tried running in the military. I got into the military. They drummed me out because I told them, the good Lord is blessing me. Right now, I got a top secret security clearance I didn't even want. And that top secret security clearance, because I was the best dental assistant in the Air Force, they told me I was, and said, that's the reason why you're going to Germany. They took me up into this little hill place, and all I was a dental assistant in a building smaller than this church for a whole bunch of guys that was down in the silos, the guys that sitting up there waiting to push that button. I was their dental assistant. But I did it good, because God said, whatever you do, do it as you do unto the Lord.
Right.
I did.
That's right.
And it got me sent to Germany. But it also got me kicked out the Air Force, because this sergeant kept saying, how come every Friday you over here in the community center instead of working? I said, well, they got a thing going on at whichever dental assistant gets the best report from his doctor all week. That doctor and that dental assistant can cancel out their Friday afternoons and start their weekend early. I had been doing it for 2 months. And the man said, well, I got to go talk to your sergeant, because your duty roster. I said, well, God bless me. He said, God ain't got nothing to do with your duty roster. What did Chris say? God got something to do with everything. Didn't know that man was sitting up there waiting on me when I had 6 weeks left on my itch. He put me on a 6 month control roster. On that 6 month control roster, during those 6 months, you can't re-enlist, you can't be promoted, you're gone. I went to the JAG office. JAG told me, he told you the truth, you might as well call home and get ready to find you a job. I called home and told my dad for the last 5 months I had dad, I'm coming home to kick me out of the Air Force. My dad said, get yourself a disability ring. And I said, I'm going to be a postal worker. What in the heck did I say that for? I never wanted to be a mailman. All of y'all that know me, what did I do for 24 years? Trust in the Lord. Do good. And I'm going to say this in close. The family. All of us in here are family.
Amen.
Amen. And what we're supposed to do, pray in one accord for God to give us his will. But when he gives you his will, what we're supposed to do, obey it. Pastor's permission, I can open the doors. If you heard anything this afternoon,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That has helped you to get a better, deeper understanding, if you have not given your life to Jesus the Christ, or if you've been away from church and you want to come back to the Lord, you can come. If you've never heard the word of God and something has been struck inside you, you can come as a candidate for baptism. But right now, what the Lord is saying to you, you're home. You're part of this family. Come back and get the benefits of what your life can be. He has blessings waiting on you if you would just come.
Oh, won't you come? Won't you come?
Thank you.
when I looked out and I saw all of our former members, I was like, oh my God. Oh, it's like home again.
Yes,
home again. Oh, God. Thank you, Jesus. So all of the ministers, deacons, and trustees' wives, please stand. Oh, gosh. I'm so happy. Greetings to our pastor, Pastor Biggs, Minister Chris Johnson, who brought the word.
Amen.
Oh, my God. The former members, current members, new members. We're saying new members because we believe in God. I just want to stand, or we're standing, first of all, to say thank you, Jesus,
yes,
for allowing us the privilege, to be here today and to say thank God for such a wonderful three-day family, church family. So on behalf of the St. Stephen's Baptist Church, our ministers and deacons and trustees' wives, we want to say thank you to all of you for taking the time out to come and share in this celebration with us. It would not have been a celebration without you, and we're so grateful to God and so thankful for blessing us with your presence today. We were unable to contact some of our former members. Some members, you know, didn't get the word out, but charge it to our heads and definitely not to our hearts. We tried as hard as we could to contact different people. So if you hear anybody saying we didn't get an invitation, tell them to. Please charge to our heads and not our hearts.
Amen.
We did try. We worked really hard. We tried. So again, thank you for coming out. There is cake and drinks in the back in the Edwardell Hayes Fellowship Hall. And there's some take-home plates back there as well. So if you're interested in, if you want some, go to the back of the Edwardell Hayes Fellowship Hall on your way out the door. Again, we want to say thank you. Thank you for coming. Thank God for this 3 days. And Sister Walden and I can just breathe. Goodbye. Amen.
Acknowledging Sister Reese Hayes.
Amen.
What a blessing. Bless you. Having co-labored with her husband for many a year.
Amen.
And God's walk of faith to lead the St. Stephen's family and the Griffin family. Amen. The Hayes family and the Griffin family. I represent you today. Amen. Thank God. Is there anyone else, Obi family, Taylor family that may be here? Don't want to miss any of them, but I did see those two families. So we thank God for you. We thank God for what he's doing. Thank God for God. You know, that is our focus now. COVID did something to us. It gave us time to pause, ponder, and clear out in our own spirits what we were doing.
Amen.
Yes.
God blessed us so many years,
yes,
so many months, so many days.
Mm-hmm.
But he's holding us accountable,
amen,
for what we do today.
Amen. Yeah. Yeah.
And so we try very hard. We strive as a body of believers to obey his word, to know his word, to apply his word to our lives, to live a life that's representative of him. Our goal is every time you come here for a worship experience, that you encounter God for yourself. We don't want to be a distraction nor a hindrance to you, but we want to be a conduit that you may have had a relationship with your God in his house.
His house. Amen.
Among his believers. every time you come. So we're truly grateful. So many people have done so much. Thank you. Thank you, MDTTW, for leadership. But thank you, brothers, for the background. Sisters, for the background. Cooks. Cooks, more cooks. Children. Decorations. Everything. Two syllable, everything. I say that word every. I say it Florida style. Yeah, but thank God for that. And we're just blessed. Pastor Jennings and your church family, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. And we're just overjoyed. Listen, I see Brother Sawyer from Atlanta, Georgia. I don't know if you're the farthest. Would you stand? Amen. Deacon Sawyer, John Oates. My son. Are there any other out-of-staters that may have traveled today? Anyone from out of state? I did see Brady on the other day, so I saw him here. How about Brady Diggs? How about out of city? Outside of San Antonio, not Converse now. Austin and Farley. Reverend Johnson, Conroe, Texas. Amen. Brother James Napa, Dallas, Fort Worth, Metro. Anyone else? I know those two. Amen. And everybody else is from here. But thank God for all of you. Thank you. Thank you, ministry. Thank you for everybody. Just thank you, thank you, thank you. Now, I'm not going to keep you if you didn't get a bone yesterday. Prayerfully, it's a bone in your carryout plate today. Pastor James, will you come and give us our benediction?
Amen.
We pray that something has been said or done today that will make a difference in your life today, tomorrow, until Jesus comes back.
Amen.
I didn't get a chance to tell this great congregation about how I got a chance to be in here. I'm not a friend. In Mark, the third chapter, it talks about that in the 21st verse, when Mark 31 through 35 stipulates, we are family.
We are.
Because we're in Christ.
Amen.
So when I step up here, I believe I'm related to you. They say, who is your mother? Who is your father? You know, back in the day when we were younger and somebody wanted to take care of your business when you wasn't doing right, they said, I had to whoop your son. You got your whooping then? And then you got home. Amen. We just want to thank you and everything, because if it had not been for Griff, because I've been part of their family and everything, and I've been knowing their father when they were here, through all the ministers that's been through here, so it just feels like I'm part of the family.
Amen.
So without further ado, we're just going to go on and bless us and say thank you for coming. You've been so gracious and loving. When I came through the door, I felt the love. Everybody that I met came and introduced themselves and said, good to see you. You know, so that just shows an extension of what the pastor has here. He has love, and he just pyramids all the way down here. So when we walked in the door, everybody came and greeted you like, you know, you were part of the family. Amen. So we
serve you for weapons,
no, no weapons for us. Amen. Come on. Amen. Yes, sir. Mom, come on, bro. Yeah, he's part of it. No, he didn't. He better quit. Father God, we just come this morning, this afternoon, as we get ready to leave this place, but not from your presence. Protect us from all hurt on the nation. Those that's traveling the highways and byways, put your angels all over them, Father God, and protect them where they can be able to go home and return safely there. We thank you for this beautiful day, Father God. For we were glad when he said, let us come into the house of the Lord. Yes. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling, to present us faultless to the only wise God, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, with the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide until we all meet again. And the church said,
amen.
We family.